Salvador, a fertile nation the size of Massachusetts, with a population of 5 million people. El Salvador is one of the five small republics of Central America, strategically situated here in the heart of the American continents. These Central American nations share a common heritage of Spanish colonial rule. But ever since President Monroe declared the Americas off limits to European imperialism in 1823, it has been United States investments and United States security interests that have dominated Central American affairs.
As one State Department memo put it in 1927, "We do control the destinies of Central America, and we do so for the simple reason that the national interest absolutely dictates such a course. Central America has always understood that governments which we recognize and support stay in power, while those we do not recognize and support fall."
Consistent with this policy, in 1954, the CIA backed a military coup that overthrew the democratically elected government of Jacobo Arbenz in Guatemala. And as early as 1913, the United States Marines invaded Nicaragua to prop up a despotic dictator there. The Marines remained in Nicaragua for two decades. Soon after, the Somoza family, backed by the U.S., took absolute control of that country. The pattern of U.S. hegemony in Central America was challenged, however, in 1979, when Nicaragua's Sandinista Liberation Front overthrew dictator Somoza. Now the U.S. is said to be fearful that other links in the U.S. chain of influence in Central America may be broken by similar revolutionary movements. In fact, at this moment, a revolution is brewing in tiny El Salvador.
In all of Latin America, no country has endured a longer period of military rule than El Salvador. The succession of military governments here began in 1932 and continued through the strong-arm regime of General Carlos Romero, who came to power in 1977 through an ill-disguised electoral fraud.
In 1978, the U.S. Defense Department asked Congress for additional military aid to El Salvador with the justification that, quote, "United States interests in El Salvador are derived from our larger concerns for regional stability in Central America. Through a modest security assistance program, we are able to maintain communication with El Salvador's military establishment, which is the country's most important political force," unquote.
Meanwhile, the blatant human rights violations of General Romero's government in El Salvador were being condemned by Amnesty International, the Organization of American States, and the U.S. State Department. The U.S. quietly began to urge Romero to resign.
October 15, 1979. A group of young Salvadoran military officers overthrow General Romero and establish a new government. The new junta includes three civilians, thus presumably ending 48 years of martial rule. The United States immediately announces its support of the junta.
But military hardliners retain key posts in the government, and extremist right-wing paramilitary organizations remain active. Skeptical of promises of reform, Salvadorans demonstrate, occupying public buildings and churches. Heavily armed government security forces and the paramilitary death squads fire into gatherings, killing hundreds. leftist guerrillas fight back, and the violent confrontations increase the number of dead left lying in the streets of San Salvador. Without the knowledge or consent of the civilian members of the junta, a United States Defense Survey team arrives in San Salvador.
January 3rd, 1980. Unable to halt the government's flagrant violations of human rights, the civilian members of the junta resign. They condemn the military for failing to begin a process of democratization and for failing to achieve closer ties with the popular movements whose existence can no longer be ignored. Fearful of a cutoff of U.S. assistance, the military persuades three other civilians to join a new junta. Violence in El Salvador continues, unabated.
February 17th, 1980. El Salvador's Archbishop Oscar Romero, a Nobel Peace Prize nominee, writes to President Carter. He pleads that the U.S. cancel a proposed $5.7 million in additional military assistance to the junta, and he warns that such interference will lead to a major bloodbath. Said the Archbishop, "The contribution of your government, instead of favoring greater justice and peace in El Salvador, will undoubtedly sharpen the repression."
Archbishop Romero's plea would go ignored. The U.S. would soon provide the military assistance in question. And in the first 3 months of 1980, the New York Times would report 3,000 Salvadorans killed, countless others tortured, exiled, or disappeared. Casualties that well surpassed the entire three-year reign of the deposed General Romero.
Early March 1980, civilian members of the second junta resign, citing their helplessness to control the repression. Once again, civilian replacements are quickly installed by the military.
March 23rd, 1980. During his Sunday sermon, broadcast nationwide, Archbishop Romero delivers a passionate appeal to police and military troops.
"I wish to make a special appeal to the men of the Army, and in particular to the rank and file of the National Guard, of the police, and of the garrisons. Brothers, you are from among the same people. You kill your own kind. Above an order to kill given by a man, the law of God must prevail. Thou shalt not kill. No soldier is required to obey an order against the law of God. Now it is time to recover your conscience and to obey your conscience. No one must obey an immoral command."
March 24th, the very next day. Archbishop Romero is gunned down at the altar by a sharpshooter as he celebrates Mass. Shockwaves reverberate throughout El Salvador, Central America, and the world. Millions mourn the loss of this simple man of God, renowned globally for his sincere and courageous defense of human rights. March 30th, Palm Sunday. 130,000 Salvadorans gather from all over the country for Archbishop Romero's funeral in San Salvador. They march through the streets in mourning and in demonstration against the government. James Harney, American journalist, recalls how a nightmare of violence unfolded in broad daylight outside the cathedral as the solemn funeral mass was underway.
"I was taking pictures in front of the cathedral, and it was an amazing experience. At one moment, the people were singing liturgical songs. And the next moment they were running for their lives when a bomb was thrown from the top of the presidential palace. The government sharpshooters were stationed up there and they began firing on the crowd. The people ran into the cathedral for cover. In the panic, many were trampled to death. Within a matter of minutes, between 7,000 and 8,000 people were jammed into the cathedral. Inside, people were yelling, "Hit the floor, hit the floor," in anticipation of the military sharpshooters firing into the cathedral. Moments later, the people were carrying in the wounded and the dead. One Salvadoran told me as I was in the cathedral, "Now you know what this government is all about, and you have the responsibility to go back to your own country and denounce it." And in the next breath, he said, "San Salvador has become a city of death."
When the bloodbath was over, the government forces played Beethoven's Ode to Joy through the loudspeakers to let the people know that it was safe to come out. With their hands over their heads to show sharpshooters that they were unarmed. The United States State Department sent a letter of condolence to the church in El Salvador after the murder of Archbishop Romero. But in the course of events, the Secretary of State indicated that the United States would continue to support the military-civilian junta.
Archbishop Romero was the seventh priest to be murdered for speaking out against the government. In fact, the entire Jesuit order has received a death threat from the right-wing vigilante group known as the White Warriors Union. Since 1977, 27 priests have been forcibly expelled from the country, and others have been detained and tortured.
And still, the repression and the fighting in El Salvador continue. The New York Times has estimated that government forces and the paramilitary death squads murder some 50 people each day. Increasingly, the Salvadoran people turn to active revolt. How long can the carnage continue?
El Salvador's Revolutionary Democratic Front, representing the political and armed forces in opposition to the government, maintains that only far-reaching social and economic changes can bring peace and stability to the strife-torn nation. They point first to the nearly feudal system of land holdings.
Here in Aguilares, the countryside is lush and the land is fertile. Yet more than three-quarters of the peasant children are malnourished. Why can't these people grow enough food to feed their families? In part because this land does not belong to them. It is owned by a small elite of coffee, cotton, and sugar growers who use it to earn millions annually in the cash export business. A scant 2% of El Salvador's population own 57% of the nation's land, and their profits buy them most of the luxuries that well-to-do people experience in more modern countries. The other side of this situation, however, is that 41% of the rural families are landless. Most live in virtual peonage on the plantations, unable to raise enough food for their own consumption. Said one farmer, Here in the countryside, all we have to eat is air. Plantation workers earn $88 a year with which to support their families. 60% are illiterate. Malnutrition, insecticide poisoning, and the virtual absence of medical care all take their toll.
In the spring of 1980, the government announced a major agrarian reform. Large plantations were to be subdivided and peasant cooperatives established. But many rich landowners divided their estates among family members in anticipation of the land redistribution, and many continued to finance the violent right-wing resistance to the reform. The military forces used the reform program as a cover to move into the countryside and assert control over the growing peasant organizations. During May 1980, the military made over 400 raids in the countryside in a style reminiscent of the Vietnam War. Villages were terrorized. There were many reports of people being tortured, raped, or shot. Said one farmer, quote, "Every day the situation in the countryside gets worse. Just yesterday we learned that the army killed 70 unarmed people at Los Naranjos farm. They kill everyone who is supporting the land reform. While the government announces the reform, the repressive forces kill everyone who is involved in it. We cannot support this. We were forced to withdraw from the reform program to fight for a government that will be sincere." Unquote.
In May, more than 700 technicians from the government's Institute for Agrarian Reform went out on strike, protesting the massive repression, the harassment of the Institute's personnel by the National Guard, and the government's failure to get land into the hands of the landless. One technician described the event that led to her disillusionment with the so-called land reform. Quote, "The troops came and told the workers the land was theirs now. They could elect their own leaders and run it themselves. The peasants couldn't believe their ears, but they held elections that very night. The next morning the troops came back, and I watched as they shot every one of the elected leaders." Unquote.
Meanwhile, this land reform program is being cited by the U.S. State Department and the North American press as proof that the Salvadoran junta is a moderate progressive government. Yet, the majority of peasants remain landless, and refugees from military campaigns in rural areas flood into the cities, where a practically frozen economy has swelled the ranks of the unemployed.
Transnational corporations are rapidly leaving El Salvador. This strife-torn nation no longer provides the kind of secure investment climate it did in the 1960s and 70s, when the plantation owners first began diversifying into industry. Wealthy Salvadorans made partnerships with foreign investors who were attracted by the cheap and plentiful labor supply in this densely populated country. El Salvador has set up special free trade zones, and U.S. import codes allow U.S. clothing manufacturers, for instance, to ship clothing components there for assembly. Finished garments are sent back to the U.S. for sale. The Salvadoran workers who sew them together earn from $2 to $6 a day for this labor.
Nobody can do it like McDonald's can.
Or take McDonald's. McDonald's in San Salvador sells their burgers and McMuffins for the same price they charge in the U.S. Their workers in San Salvador, however, earn only $3 per day. In spite of generally low wages and poor working conditions, all but three strikes in El Salvador's labor history have been declared illegal. These workers at the Emis factory successfully struck for moderate wage increases, but then the company decided to close up shop and leave town altogether. The workers' small gains quickly turned to dust. They are occupying this factory as a last resort to protest the company's decision to leave.
The Salvadorans are increasingly unwilling to pass on the legacy of exploitation and poverty to their children. At the risk of death, they are joining the popular organizations which are uniting within the Revolutionary Democratic Front, and they are fighting back. Government sources and the North American press commonly label members of these groups as extremists, terrorists, and subversives. And yet the U.S. Embassy, which is one of the principal sources of support for the beleaguered junta, estimates that a majority of the nation's population supports the opposition. The Revolutionary Democratic Front represents virtually all of the major Salvadoran opposition groups, peasant and worker unions, professional associations, and student organizations. The size of these opposition groups increased dramatically after peaceful means of reform had failed. Two elections were held in El Salvador during the last decade, but in both, sure victories by the moderate opposition candidates were reversed by massive electoral frauds. Now, the Revolutionary Democratic Front is receiving widespread support for its armed struggle against the current regime and the military which protects its interests. As one woman put it, "Here in El Salvador, we have two choices, to die of hunger or to fight."
These people are part of a group of 400 so-called extremists who organized to occupy an abandoned cattle ranch in the San Vicente region. The people on this farm came here driven from their homes by violence and hunger. They grow subsistence crops and are on constant alert for military attacks.
Nosotros ya nos cansamos de tanto atropello que se nos ha hecho.
We are tired of being the ones that suffer. We are the mothers of these babies. We need their daily bread and milk. That's why we, the Salvadoran women, have become revolutionaries now. But this revolution is one of hunger. So I, as a mother, with all these years behind me, have begun to understand. They talk about an international year of the child. I wonder what child that could be. It must be the American child. For this child, there is nothing.
Pero para este niño, no hay nada.
One Salvadoran man from the countryside wondered, "The Americans love to call us terrorists, but when the authorities disembowel people, why is that not terrorism? The soldiers rob us of what little we have, they burn our houses, they keep our children illiterate and malnourished. Isn't that terrorism?"
Of the Salvadoran junta, United States citizens have already spent millions of tax dollars on riot gear, munitions, transportation and communications technology, and on the training of nearly 2,000 military personnel. It is not clear that the junta has any real control over El Salvador's security forces. Nonetheless, a further $5.5 million of military assistance is scheduled to be appropriated in the fiscal 1981 budget. $50 million has already gone towards backing the poorly managed agrarian reform.
Many political observers fear that the U.S. might soon go beyond monetary support to direct military intervention in El Salvador. President Carter created the Joint Caribbean Task Force, which has carried out war games in the area with a fleet of over 200 vessels, 20,000 soldiers, and 50 aircraft. In a recent network interview, presidential candidate Ronald Reagan would not rule out the use of that force in the near future.
For many, the question to be asked is, why does the Salvadoran government need so much military assistance to keep its own people under control? And why does the United States take it upon itself to foot the bill? The political cost to the U.S. has been heavy. In the eyes of its Latin American neighbors, the United States is now being identified with guns, helicopters, disappeared relatives, and with corpses lying in blood-stained streets, not with its own ideals of democracy and social justice. Murat Williams, former U.S. ambassador to El Salvador, wrote in the New York Times, quote, "Look at the death toll in El Salvador for the first few months of 1980. I shudder to think how many people have been killed with weapons made in the United States and shipped under our aid programs. Do we really want to send more weapons for greater carnage? Do we know who will ultimately bear the arms and pull the triggers? Recent reports suggest that most victims have been the humble Salvadorans, those who have already suffered the tragedy of extreme poverty under the eyes of the masters of extreme wealth." Unquote.
The State Department's policies towards El Salvador have been criticized by both liberals and conservatives for being two-faced. The U.S. condemns the flagrant human rights violations committed by military forces in countries such as El Salvador. Yet, it continues to fuel the very machinery used by those same forces to step up their repression of human rights. Concerning the U.S. human rights policy, one Salvadoran woman commented.
A lo que yo pienso, como madre, como obrera.
As for what I think as a mother, as a worker, perhaps I can't express it very well. But yes, I think that human rights is something the North Americans have only for themselves. For us, there is nothing.
Para nosotros, no hay nada.